Today's video is going to be just a little bit different. A while back, I was contacted by someone from Banggood about doing product reviews on my channel. Now, at first I wasn't on board with that, but after some back and forth about what would be expected from me, I'd started to warm up to it a little bit. I don't have an infinite amount of resources to put into my channel, so I thought this might be a good way of getting some things that I wouldn't normally be able to purchase or just weren't on my radar that I think would be applicable to this channel. I was allowed to pick an item that I thought would be relevant to what my viewers would be interested in, so I did, and this is it. Now, if you guys hate this concept, feel free to let me know in the comments, and I am going to be looking at all the feedback I get. Now, this is not something that could ever be a mainstay for the channel, but if there is something that I think would be directly relevant to what you guys see on my channel, then I would consider it. So, let's take a look at this. I picked this item off of Banggood's site based on what I thought would be relevant to what people would watch. So I picked an EEPROM reader and programmer. Now I went with this EEPROM reader package in particular for a reason. I have seen other people talk about this EEPROM reader as being pretty good, but I wanted to see for myself. And this exact listing also comes with these adapter sockets that would allow me to put in uncommon or non-DIP packages and actually read or write the contents from those. So this should have a lot of functionality. Now, what kind of things would a vintage computer user use an EEPROM programmer for? Well, it's going to really depend on how into your computers you get. If you're like me and you have no problem getting in and repairing them, then this could be something you'd want to add to your repertoire. One thing I plan on doing with this is archiving a particularly uncommon cartridge I have for the Atari 800 computers. This came with an 800 I got that was used as a television channel listing station generator. So there is code on here that was semi-proprietary, so I would like to back that up for posterity. However, before I start any of that, I'm going to take some time unrecorded and become familiar with this device. I'm not just going to go into this gung-ho and then recommend it based off of a chance of success. I want to know how the software works, I want to test the operating system compatibility, and I want to see if I can get it to work on Linux. We'll see how it goes after I've done some research. Okay, I've been testing this thing off and on for a few days now, and I feel capable of giving a real opinion on it. So, first off, let's go over what features this device has. Now, when I chose this programmer, I didn't put much thought into the model that I picked. I just wanted one that looked like this. This is a clone of the popular TL866 Mini Pro programmer. Like the Mini Pro, this programmer supports over 13,000 devices, except that this is a TL866II+, so it claims to support over 15,000 devices. This is because this model can program 1.8 volt devices. However, to gain that, it dropped 21 volt support, which is a bit of a problem for how I envisioned using this. But we'll get to that in a bit. Additionally, this model also features the ICPI programming feature, which means if you're a fan of microcontroller projects, you can use this as an external programmer for custom boards on some chips. Now, let's get to the software. Initially, I wanted a stock experience, so I installed this on Windows 10. I didn't use the software from the disk and instead went straight to their website to get the newest version. Like the hardware, the software is also a clone of the Mini Pro. And on first startup, with the programmer connected, it wants to update the firmware. After doing that, though, we can try it to verify that it works by dropping in a device and filling it with something. It's looking good here. Now, I'm a Linux user, so before we go on, I'd rather run this on Linux. Now, there is an open source project to work with the TL866 programmer for Linux, but it specifically does not work with the 2+ I have here. It even goes so far as to blacklist its device ID. So hacking this device in probably isn't gonna work. So we're left with trying to get the Windows program running, which actually works pretty well. You'll want to extract the files from the installer on Linux. I had tried copying and running the files from my Windows installation, only to be met with language file problems in both 32 and 64 bits of Wine.
But once you have the files extracted properly in Wine, you'll need to get a modified version of the Wine USB library and place it in the directory with the program. I'm not a huge fan of this workaround. There's a good chance that this USB hack will break compatibility with Wine after future updates, so your mileage may vary on this. But for now it works, and we can launch the programming software. Now that we're in here for good, let's try doing some real work with this. Back to that Atari 800 board I'd shown earlier. There are two EEPROMs on here that are holding the program data, and together this functions as a standard cartridge for the system. I would demo the cart, but I don't know where my PSU for my 130XE is, and I don't feel like trying to make one either because I have to solve the fact that this only outputs RF, or I have to make another custom cable to connect to the monitor, and I can't use an XEGS because this cartridge just doesn't fit in there. So until I get around to doing some work to get myself up and running again with my Atari 8-bit computers, you'll just have to take my word that this is an uncommon TV channel listing generator cartridge. So to read the data, we can pull the chip out, drop it in the slot, select the correct device, and read the data. Rinse and repeat for the other side, and we have a complete backup. After you have both parts, you can use the software as a hex editor to join the ROMs. Let's load in the first one again, and note where the data starts and ends. Now let's reload it, but change where it's loaded into memory. Next, let's load the other ROM, but put it at the end of the first one, and tell it not to clear everything in the buffer. Now we can save this as one joined ROM file. If you wanted to go through and find a 16K chip to use instead and fake it, you could skip this next part. But the files I just created are 64K, because that's what size the ROM chips are, so I need to run a quick DD command to get just the first 16K into a different file. And that's a ROM backup. Now, I spent about an hour trying to get an emulator to actually load this ROM that I just made, but I couldn't do it. It detects it as a ROM, and it seems like it starts to load it, but it never works. I can make it fail if I try to load it as a 5200 cartridge instead, though, so I know loading it as an NTSC 130XE cart is at least partially working. I've linked the raw ROM files in the description, so if you know more than I do about making this work, I would love some help. Okay, so we can read data. Now let's try writing data. I'll grab a random EEPROM I've got to try it out. Again, we just select the correct chip and we're ready to go. Now I don't have anything in particular that I want to write at the moment, so I'm just gonna fill the buffer and then change one of the bytes so I know that it's new data on there. Again, this only changes the buffer. We still need to write the device by clicking here and accepting. After it's done, we can restart the program and reread the chip to fully verify that the data was written. Now, a little interesting thing. While playing around with this, I have noticed a weird issue. It identifies some chips as being electrically erasable PROMs, but it doesn't let me try to erase it. The chip has a window, so it should be UV erasable anyway. While we're talking about issues, let's get back to the 21-volt programming problem. Older devices than I've shown so far can require 21 volts to be programmed, but this doesn't support that. This 8088 motherboard, for example, has a BIOS chip that falls into this category. After peeling back the sticker just enough to see the part number, if we try to find it in the device list, we cannot. And looking at the datasheet, we can see that it is a 21-volt device. Now, in all fairness, the 21-volt capable TL866 doesn't list support for this chip either. Now, the page for these things all show that the 21-volt capable versions have been discontinued, and it seems like the manufacturer really only wants to push the 2+ version I have now. So a 21-volt programmer is either going to be old stock or used. That's something you're going to have to keep in mind if you're interested in one of these. I still want to try doing a ROM dump on a motherboard's BIOS, so let's go to the opposite end of the spectrum and kill two birds with one stone. This LGA775 board has a socketed PLC BIOS ROM, which I've pulled out already. I would have put it back in to get a shot of it coming out, but it wasn't easy, and I didn't get the dip polar pictured with my programmer kit. I didn't have a chance to contact Banggood about this before the review, so I don't know if they would have been able to send me one if I'd mentioned it, but I've had one of these cheaper ones in the past, though, and I can tell you, if you don't get it, you're not really missing anything. Now, this kit does come with something far more useful than the dip polar, the adapters. Obviously, some parts like this PLC don't fit in the dip socket on the reader, so you have these adapters as a way to give you many more options for different chip packages. With the PLC chip in the socket, and after having lifted the BIOS revision sticker to see the part number, we can get data off of it. For grins and giggles, I went ahead and saved that ROM file and compared it to the 1305 ROM you can download from ASUS's website, and they don't match at all. But it does seem to be a pretty good match for the 3001 ROM. And if we take a look at a diff of the two files, there's only one very minor difference between the two, and I'm going to guess that's just the flash date information because there seems to be more information in the ROM file that I dumped versus the one that I downloaded. It's pretty cool to be able to see you can get the original ROM file back out of the motherboard. Well, that's about everything I wanted to cover. But before I end this, I want to give a final verdict, since this is a review and not one of my typical overviews. So here are some of my pros and cons for this kit. Pro, it has a large assortment of compatible chips, but con, 21-volt chips are not supported. Another con, no native Linux client and the open source ones don't support it, but pro, the Windows drivers are fine and very easy to use with Wine. Another pro, it has a lot of adapters. But con, I also wanted to dump a Genesis cartridge, but it was a 42-pin dip that is longer than the socket. And I have a few more pros with no remaining counterpoints. It seems really fast, I had no reliability issues, the built-in hex editor in the software isn't bad, and it has a lot more useful but somewhat specific features I didn't get to. My overall experience was definitely positive, but ultimately whether or not the value proposition of $58 for one of these is up to you. But if you like to work with lower level electronics and or want to archive some carts or BIOS, then it's definitely worth considering. And thus concludes my review. Again, let me know what you think of the idea of me reviewing things like this in the comments. I always read all the comments on my video, but I will be paying extra attention to these ones. I hope this was useful, and I'll see you next time.